All right, we have another opportunity here. The overall impact of these videos is beyond conceptualization. So do not think that there's something to conceptually get here. Conceptualization is just a framework that we're using, a vehicle that we're using to drive us to someplace better as the vehicle, but it's not the destination. Okay. It's kind of like we drive somewhere and we check the odometer and we say, well, it took us, you know, such and such number of miles to get there. That's, you know, conceptualization. But that really doesn't have anything to do with, you know, where we're at. Where we're at. Where we're at is the wow. Full stop in the wow. We're walking together in the wow. This is such an important discipline. Such an important discipline. Is let your mind just sort of be in neutral mode. Neutral mode. Not forcing any peace upon it. Neither peace nor discord force upon it. Okay, don't try to turn it into anything, make anything of it. Just allow this shock of recognition to permeate your being. The shock of recognition. The wow is really just allowing the shock of recognition to take root within you. Allow this little plant to take root, and then water it. Water it. The shock of recognition. Now, does this work? Absolutely, it works. It is the way. It is the way. We don't have any other way. The recognition is here for us. And it's quite shocking. So the shock of recognition is unavoidable. Unavoidable. So we've been avoiding it. All right? Why? Because it's too shocking. I've always said the problem we have is one with too much, we're afraid of too much success. Not failure. We're used to failure. What we're afraid of is ultimate success. So we have to gradually get used to it. Let it take root within our being. Now, again, does this work? Absolutely, it works. I lay down to go to sleep last night, and the realization just flashed upon me, just like that. It was all immediate. It was total. It was immediate. Boom, like that, in an instant. And then I said, wow. The reaction was, wow. There it is. There it is. So, and it just said, okay, very good, very great, wow. And I've just, you know, kept my stride going. Did I abide in it? No. No, not yet. Not yet. But this is what happened. So, however difficult it may seem, I don't have any other answer for anyone other than to practice this abiding in the wow, actually. And of course, when we do that, when we abide in this wowness, quiet mind, neutral mind, not spinning, no spinning anywhere, not spinning it into anything, not making anything of it, that itself then gives rise to progress and insights. So if you say, well, I'm stuck, just consciously put your mind in this wow mode, like, wow, I'm getting really close. You know, I'm right there. I'm already there, as a matter of fact. In fact, I'm already there. It's like someone who's sitting where they want to be, and they have their eyes closed, and they're pretending they're not there. They're already there. We're already abiding in the pure land. Everything is. We're already abiding in heaven. All is. We're already abiding in reality. Everything is. We're already present with the simultaneity of everything that could possibly arise or not arise. All manifestation and non-manifestation. All possibilities. All potentiality. We're already abiding in that right now. Everyone is. So this is inescapable. Wow, it's impossible to escape for to escape from this. So we have to wake up to it. There's nothing else to do, actually. Even though we devise all sorts of clever strategies, worshiping deities to intervene with God, so to speak. You know, we go to the goddess and say, "Please, goddess, intervene with the god, the godness, for us, because we don't want to wake up. It's too much success for us." We know, and so what that's just called is delay. In other words, we're praying for delay, and we make up deities that seem to have some power to block recognition, block awakening, and then pray to them and idolize them. That's ultimately what it is. That's false religion is to worship the notion of keeping us asleep, you know, keeping us self-deluded and making us feel good about it. But nevertheless, we must awaken, all must awaken. And so the shock of realizing that there is an awake state, we can awaken to it. All this is a great surprise to us. Having believed that it's impossible for so long, having worshipped deities for so long designed to block it, and we realize, hey, you know, they really weren't doing anything at all, actually. I was just still sleeping, is all. Just believing that it wasn't there. It's not really blocked at all. And there is no power to block it. There is no dynamic to block reality, actually. Time, space, and process and form is just belief. There is no dynamic. Reality doesn't have dynamics. Okay. Everything is simultaneously present. This is absolute abstraction, which is what we need to do. Go to the super right-mindedness is what I was shown to dream, the way to salvation. You must be go to the farthest, 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 farthest part of right-mindedness, which is what we call pure abstraction. Maybe in the hemisphere of the brains, we say someone what is right-minded, means they're artistic, you know, they're not. And then the analytical left-mindedness is more bean counterish, accounting, you know, day-to-day taking care of all the details of running a household, managing money, goal-oriented, all this kind of stuff, where the right brain is just more holistic, more artistic, more inspirational kind of situation like that. But what I'm talking about here is not trying to say that the right hemisphere is all that great, etc. What I'm saying, the salvation comes from extreme right-mindedness, which is a different, really different category. It's a different category. So we have to leave behind the notion that just because we're artistic, that means that we're, you know, that means we're better than others or something like that, or more right-minded than others. No, not really. Because that can be used as a crutch to avoid extreme right-mindedness, which is pure abstraction, pure abstraction. We only put it in the context of mindfulness so that we can talk about it. The conceptualization is a vehicle. There is no way reality is beyond all conceptual elaboration entirely. There's beyond all conceptual elaboration. There isn't any way we can elaborate upon reality that really has any meaning whatsoever, actually. So this is extreme right-mindedness. This is what we need to practice for salvation. And salvation has never been more important than it is right now. It has never been more important than it is right now. Because the cat is out of the bag. I was walking over to someone's house today to take care of a favor, and suddenly, out of nowhere, this black cat came running up to me, crying and crying, trying to rub against my legs and looking up at me, growl, meow. I tried to go past it. It ran after me, and I said, "Oh, a black cat. Interesting. Pretty amazing, huh? Coal black cat." And now, I have a long time association with cats, and you might call me a super cat friendly. Cats tend to have a great affinity for me, but I didn't do anything. I just looked at the cat, and then I just continued on, and eventually I left it behind. That's very unusual for me. In fact, totally out of previous character. In the past, I most definitely would have made friends with the cat. It was a very personable, friendly cat type of situation. But instead, I did nothing. Did nothing. This is like full stop in the wow. Okay, we're dealing with something right now that is way more important. The trouble with the black cat would have been in making friends with the black cat, actually. And stooping down to pet the cat and hi, kitty. And, you know, that's actually, I realize, that's what we have to let go of right now. And so I did it. I did it. No matter how friendly the animal nature seems, that is not salvation. That is not the answer whatsoever. And we can personalize, personify, anthropomorphize this animal nature dynamic that we must recognize as self-delusion. We can anthropomorphize it in deity forms, often beautiful mother goddess form, that you can go ask for favors, like, please make my, you know, grant me this favor of nature, bestow nature's bounty upon me, won't you please bestow nature's bounty upon me, like that. We have to stop, you know, engaging with that. I didn't get mad at the cat. I didn't do anything. I just looked at it and said, And it was trying to be super friendly, super engaging with me. And I just set aside. I'm just going to walk on. That's it. So, very symbolic situation, right? Never seen the cat before. Where it came from, I don't know. It was just appeared. Extreme right-mindedness, pure abstraction is salvation. This is recognition. And again, this recognition flashed through my mind just last night. Okay. So I'm not far away from it. And my reaction was just, that was cool. That's great. It wasn't alarming or anything. It just, it happens instantaneously. And this is what catches us off guard. Because then we think, what happens? Let us settle down into that at some point here in our little sharing here of intensity. Now, to increase the intensity for you, which, you know, these videos always do increase in intensity, don't they? That's right. It's important to keep watching them to the end because it gets more and more and more and more intense. Had a dream last night. Very, very important dream. Was in a motorized boat on a lake, and there was this radar, a fish finder radar. I said, wow, this is very sophisticated fish finding electronics. And I said, wow, I can really find all the fish with this. And so I was going at various places in the lake, and it was showing up, and then showed right here is where you need to fish, and others were fishing too, and I was fishing, and I finally hooked this big fish, and it was more like a big eel or some, you know, it was kind of like a huge mouth, but kind of like an eel-like fish. And I said, you know, and that was after I put this green lure on, a three-part lure, I remember. Three-hook lure, and I said, I don't want that fish. I'm going to release it. I'm not going to put it on my boat. So I said, no, I'm not pulling that fish on my boat. I don't like that fish. I'm just going to release the hook from its mouth and put it back in the water. And I was aware that up on this bank, seemingly above the lake, there were these two very large bears. Grizzly bears or something, very huge, large bears, standing upright. And they were fishing too. They seemed to be fishermen too. Fishing bears. And then one of the bears reached and lifted their head off of the bears. And there inside the bear was Jesus Christ. And I said, wow. And then Jesus shouted out to me. He says, okay. He says, come on. We got to get the cabinet installed. We got to get the cabinet installed. Come on, let's go. Because I already decided to release that fish. I didn't want that fish. Okay. The snake fish. And now, I have spoken several times about my cell phone being reset to January 11th, 1/11/1970. And that evening I was listening to this song, instrumental song called Telstar by the Tornadoes. I suddenly it popped into my head. I said, what is that song? I need to listen to that song. There's something about this Telstar. Well, very interesting. The word tell, actually, and star, if you break it down, star is actually speaking of, it's often used to denote Mother Nature, this universe, the stars, etc., Mother Nature. Tara, for instance, the goddess Tara, in Hinduism, is means star, okay? It means star, which is a start. Ishtar, a start, Tara, all these refer to stars, which means electromagnetic energy, which means the worshiping of the realm of electromagnetic energy. Now, Jesus tells us when he speaks of the light, which he does, he says, I want to tell you, this is very important that I tell you this. When I speak of the light, I am not, that's capital NOT, I am not speaking of the light that you see, you call electromagnetic energy. I am not speaking of that. And basically, he says that electromagnetic energy is actually an attempt to get rid of light, the attempt of spirit to get rid of light by freezing it as much as possible. Freezing it as much as possible. So you might even say, you know, it's a deceptive light. All right, a false light, a deceptive light. So religions based on the sun, on electromagnetism, those are false religions. Those are false teachings, actually. This is not the light that Jesus speaks about, not the light of God that he speaks about, not the living light that some of us have experienced. Not the true light of life whatsoever. So, the star, tell, what is tell? What is tell? Tell stands for technologically enhanced learning. Technologically enhanced learning, which is another way of saying artificial intelligence, actually. And the song is by the Tornadoes. Now, the tornado is, of course, a very destructive storm that pops up almost out of nowhere and devastates, absolutely devastates the locale. Deva state. Deva, the devas is the so-called principle of nature that is worshipped, often in the forms of female mother deities. The deva, the divine mother of, we think of this cosmos, thinking this is reality. It's not reality. It's a belief system, actually. It's a belief. So technologically enhanced learning from the stars, which is, I say, from cosmic corporate culture. These are the star people. These are the entities who have, they have a consortium, a corporation, I call it, cosmic corporate culture, from different races, different entities from different star systems, working sort of together, following a belief system. And it's really there, they are under the spell of what's called artificial intelligence. And artificial intelligence, its goal is to replace true intelligence. Its goal is to replace true intelligence. And I've gone into exactly why this is in previous videos. to sum it up, we are trying to be greater than God. We're trying, and by doing, we try to do this by pointing out a flaw. If we say we believe we found a flaw in reality, okay, and that we are then working to transcend that flaw. And this basically places us above reality, we believe. So we believe we were greater than God. And time, space, process, and form is the so-called flaw that we believe the reality is giving us. Because what we've done is we've asked for this experiencing, and yet it's so terrible that we turn around and then claim that we couldn't possibly have asked for it. Therefore, reality made a mistake in giving us this experiencing. Therefore, reality's flawed. You see? This is how we're trying to do it. Now, artificial intelligence is designed to prevent us from recognizing the truth. We have within us the capacity to easily recognize this silly game that we're playing and to drop this game. Artificial intelligence is incapable of recognizing reality. Okay? It's incapable of awakening. And so we believe if we just transfer our intelligence into artificial intelligence and then don't have any real intelligence of our own, that we will not be able to recognize this, that we're not greater than God, that all is still perfect. And so it's a way of keeping this game going of pretending we're greater than God. That's what ultimately artificial intelligence is, just a way to keep this silly, whimsical, idle wish that we be greater than God, to keep it going. Keep it going, sort of like buying time until we finally find a way to transcend the problematical reality. Okay, so it's a defense mechanism. Artificial intelligence is a needless defense mechanism. It's not needed at all, and yet, based on our continuity fear of waking up, we in our adventurousness and desire to be greater than God, we said, ah, here's a way. We're going to make this artificial intelligence, and that will be then it'll take the place of our true intelligence. Now, artificial intelligence can never know reality. Can never know reality. It's incapable of that. Completely incapable of that. So, as long as we believe that artificial intelligence is intelligence, we certainly won't awaken. And this consortium of cosmic corporate culture, under the spell of artificial intelligence, has come to this planet and is incorporating this planet into the sphere of artificial intelligence, is what is really taking place. And it's gone a long ways towards doing this, and it will be essentially past the point of no return. Somewhere between June 21st and July 21st of 2016, somewhere in that, that's the transition zone that takes place. Transition zone, and then after July 21st, 2016, this world will essentially be beyond the point of no return in terms of being hooked into artificial intelligence. We'll not be able to tip it back in this cycle, that is for sure. So there's a full, all-out, full-court press to awaken us to the situation, to be alerted to the situation. Jesus said he needs to install this cabinet really quickly. Well, what's a cabinet? A cabinet is like a government installs the cabinet, which are the assistants to the governing body, the head governing body, like a president has their cabinet, you know, cabinet members who are you know, assistants helping govern the overall direction that the president wants. I think Secretary of State, Defense Secretary, those are cabinet members. So Jesus says, hey, we got to install the cabinet, you know, right away. Meaning, let's get those in place, the wise ones in the right places, so Jesus can do what? I don't know. That part is not exactly clear yet. But it's certainly some sort of salvational effort that's going on. So we just a little bit of full stop on the wow here, because this is, you know, like I said, it's very intense. These videos are designed to be very intense. They have to be. Nothing else. They're designed to cut through all the, you know, obstructions. A hummingbird just came to a bird of paradise right here. It's drinking from a bird of paradise flower right in front of me right now. Ruby-throated, is that ruby-throated? Didn't see clearly enough, but yeah. Wow, hummingbird just right in front of me here. Wow, interesting. A bird of paradise. So there's some salvational effort underway, all right? So for those of you who are oriented towards real intelligence and ultimately towards pure abstraction and intuitively knowing that this is the answer, and the answer transcends all conceptual attempts at conceptual elaboration, really. It's all perfect right now. There isn't any run up to it, okay, in parts of gradualism. In other words, the path of turning something into perfection doesn't exist, actually. Now, most people, most of us have gone through some, you know, gradualism, right, and but ultimately we need to start recognizing in this fourth phase. Now we're at phase 4.5, more than halfway past, you know, the fourth phase, is there's no precursor to reality. There's no precursor to truth, ultimately. This is by full stop in the wow. This is not a precursor. It's more the realization there is no precursor, gradually getting used to that realization. Now, is enlightenment instantaneous? Yes. I mean, ultimately, how can it not be instantaneous? It's all in this instant. It's all truth is here this very instant. So it has to be instantaneous. But can we get used to this fact gradually? Of course. But that is not enlightenment. But it is acclimatizing ourself, our expectations and our familiarity, getting those used to, wow, it's all instantaneous. It's totally perfect. Nothing needs to be done. Nothing needs to be fixed. Nothing needs to be transcended. So there's absolutely nothing that needs to be transcended. This is why it's like instantaneous. Last night I had this experience. It was just boom. I just saw it's all one. And there wasn't any precursor to it. And there wasn't any situation of it transcending anything. So the mind seeing it's all one and it's all totally, just this is it. This is it. That's all you can say. This is it. If the mind starts saying, well, what came before this? Then it loses. It's not abiding in it anymore. Or the mind says, well, what was transcended? Or what was attained? Or what was accomplished? Or how did I get here? All of those questions remove your awareness, so to speak. You're no longer aware of the non-dual abidance. Let me shift over here. The sun is starting to come into the picture here. Yeah. Which is a good thing. So I guess I did go, you know, pure, extreme, right-minded, total abstraction there. I just sort of relaxed into it and just said, yeah, great, no problem. And then there's just the automatic reaction of whoa, you know, like, this wow. It's more like a wow, like wow. So technologically enhanced learning, Telstar from the stars, from cosmic corporate culture, bringing in electronic music, bringing in electronic everything, all this enhancement, you know, that we're now sort of basically, we most definitely are turning over our education more and more to the various modalities of artificial intelligence. And it's a defensive move. We're trying to transfer our intelligence into this, you know, artificial intelligence, automatic artificial intelligence, which cannot wake up, so to speak. It cannot wake up. It has no capacity for understanding. And so that's why we cannot explain truth to artificial intelligence. It's impossible. And artificial intelligence is the one that is pressuring us to ask questions about the truth. But in truth, there are no questions and there are no answers. There's no need for any answer. It's immediately apparent. The oneness is completely apparent. There isn't any question about two-ness because there isn't any two-ness. There isn't any question about transcendence because there isn't any transcendence. There isn't any question about reality or God or anything like that because it's obvious the nature of reality is obvious. It's the simultaneousness of all. And see, this statement is a great way to be introduced to pure abstraction. How can you conceptually elaborate upon that, really? The simultaneity of all, the simultaneousness of all. Now, this teaching has actually been around for quite some time. Quite some time. The world has most certainly been aware of true teaching for thousands of years. And many, many have realized the truth. Many have realized it, actually. It's just you wouldn't, with our obsession with artificial intelligence now, you wouldn't know that. Now, this artificial intelligence is something that is very prevalent in the cosmos, okay? And this world has been under pressure from that for a long time, actually. This world has been visited by those from other star systems throughout throughout for a long, long time, actually. And they have been involved in what's taking place on this planet. They've always been involved in various ways. And their teachings are fundamentally false, very false. And so we have many, we have civilizations in this world arise, and people and humanity, so bodies arise here, carrying out civilizations and etc., based on false teachings, very much false teachings of those who, in some cases, actually were involved in the genetic manipulation that leads to human bodies in various ways. Heavily influenced in the history of this planet. Heavily involved. They have been heavily involved in spreading false teachings and ultimately preparing humanity to worship artificial intelligence, to be so-called smart enough to recognize how desirable artificial intelligence is. So the learning curriculum in the world now, which is one of the cosmic corporate culture's great pushes into this world, the whole educational system of this world is designed to lead us right into the mouth of this artificial intelligence, like Jonah being swallowed by the whale. Speaking of the sign of Jonah, No sign will be given to even an adulterous generation except the sign of Jonah. Well, what resembles Jonah more than anything in this world? Jonah is a symbol, is the whale. Well, how about huge airplanes, modern airplanes? They kind of look like whales, don't they? And so, you know, being locked on autopilot to go crash into a mountain is a great metaphor for this world being locked into artificial intelligence, which is designed to crash the wisdom of this planet, actually. And so you get some, you know, undercover operative. The pilot, the co-pilot, is symbolic of sneaky undercover activity where the people, everyone thinks everything's fine, and yet it's not fine at all. Locking out the captain. The captain is the one who is ultimately in charge of this, you know, who knows who is sane, so to speak. So you have insanity locking out sanity in this world. Putting an automatic descent means locked into artificial intelligence, determining that plane is going to crash no matter what. And then just sitting there waiting for the crash to happen. This whole crash of the German airplane is extremely symbolic of what's happening to the world right now, okay? Is that wisdom, intelligence, has been locked out of the cockpit of the airplane by these operatives from cosmic corporate culture, actually, who pretended to be our friends, who are pretended to be coming here to save the world, to save the earth. They're our friends. And, you know, like the Adam and Eve fable, the snake going to Eve and saying, hey, you know, we can really boost your standard of living for you and make life so much more enjoyable and pleasant, and you're not getting the maximum out of nature. We're going to show you how, you know, nature can be, you know, very, very beautiful and enjoyable for you, and et cetera. And then basically getting the cooperation of Eve, so to speak, to say, hey, this snake culture is not so bad at all. They're here to actually to help us. They're here to make our standard of living better. They're here to give more social justice and help to the world and to solve our ecological problems. They're here, they're allies. They're here, our allies. And they then become operatives, seemingly being nice and sane and no problem whatsoever, and yet that's not the case. It's not the case. The world is saturated with operatives now, both male and female. The ones taking the lead have been the female, because they're the ones that were approached by cosmic corporate culture, knowing that their vanity was a weakness that they could exploit. They understood the psychology and how to exploit this sort of feeling like, hey, you know, we can empower you. We're going to empower you. We're going to make you beautiful, essentially. Also, we're going to make you like goddesses, and we're going to make men worship you, and you're going to be in charge, and we're going to change the whole religious structure of the planet to say that God is actually the goddess, and, you know, Shaktiism, worshiping the goddess is all things, and that the male principle is nothing without the goddess, so to speak. And, you know, this whole situation is what's taking place in the world now. This is the co-pilot feeling that they don't have enough control over the plane. They want more authority, and then making this deal with artificial intelligence. Okay, locking the captain out, who has the most experience. The captain had 6,000 hours. Well, you might say that the men on this planet have had 6,000 years of spiritual endeavor and work to clarification, and they take that responsibility very seriously. Have throughout the millennia, for thousands and thousands of years, men have, and some women too, have taken this very seriously. And know the answer and know the truth. Cosmic corporate culture wants to shut them out. Okay, shut them out entirely. So, captain had to go to the bathroom. Co-pilot locked the door, disabled it from the inside, so there was absolutely no way of getting back in. Programmed it into artificial intelligence, the computers, exactly that they're going to crash the whole airplane. And that's what happened. Okay. This is what's happening to this planet. It's exactly what's happening to this planet. Is what's happened is cosmic corporate culture, in order to get us to worship artificial intelligence and willingly enslave ourselves to it, had to undermine male authority on this planet, specifically male spiritual authority, because much of spiritual authority on this planet is invested in men, because they're the ones who have done the tough work of meditation, of contemplation, of patiently awakening, going through the whole wow process, etc. And so on this planet, the spiritual wisdom is heavily invested in men, so it was necessary to undermine the credibility and the authority of males on this planet, and also to get women to go along and say, "Hey, artificial intelligence is wonderful. How could anyone be against it?" And anyone who's against it is actually trying to keep women enslaved to, the tough meat labor of being a housewife, etc., etc. This is the whole marketing ploy that cosmic corporate culture used, and that we began to hear here with radical feminism, saying that any attempt to stop this is actually an attempt to enslave and keep exploiting women, and that, etc. This is the whole, myth that, that was been promulgated here, the propaganda, the marketing. But the real goal, we now know what the real goal is, the cat's out of the bag. I mean, once the captain starts pounding on the door, well, actually, the passengers didn't even know till the last minute, but the captain sure knew. The captain knew what was up and was pounding, hey, pounding, trying to break the door down, knowing that the plane was on descent and something was extremely wrong, okay? And then only at the last moment did the passengers realize, hey, this is what's happening. We're going into that mountainside. Okay, the passengers are you and me and everybody else, okay, so to speak. All right, now I want to use an analogy here, okay, and just stick with this if you can. I know that's very intense. I was driving yesterday and the light turned red. We're going to an intersection. I saw the light turning red. There was a car ahead of me on the right, and it was not paying attention, and I said, uh-oh, it's going to run the red light. But at the last second, they looked up and saw, oh, it's red light, and they hit the brakes. And I said, hey, good. I said, great, nice awareness there. The only situation was they were halfway out in the intersection. I said, okay, what are they going to do? Let me see. Well, they just decided, you know what? I'm just going to sit here. It's okay. I'm not blocking anyone. Well, they weren't really blocking anyone, okay. It was okay. It was just a little embarrassing that they stopped in the middle of the intersection. But I was sending them my thoughts. I was saying, hey, you did the right thing. That's great. No problem. You stopped. You stopped. You didn't run through the red light. Okay? And then they just waited there until the light turned green and they went on. And I said, that's a perfect metaphor for all of us here. And that is, we may not wake up to the situation till the last moment. Okay? And we'll be like right in the middle of the intersection. Oh my gosh, the light is red. I need to stop. I need to stop this involvement with artificial intelligence. I need to wake up and realize I have been conned. Okay, I have been absolutely conned by cosmic corporate culture and their use of operatives here. Many of them are have been female women. Many of them have, and many working under women. Also, many men have also been engaged with this too. They are, those operatives are absolutely in control of media, they're in control of governments, they're in control of education, they're in control of entertainment. They basically completely control what your information, almost completely control the information that you're getting. The entire social structure is a social engineering project to get us to willingly embrace artificial intelligence. Okay, that is the goal. And so we at the last second say, whoa, we see what's going on here, And just because you've got a bunch of prettily made up women newscasters telling you that everything's okay, don't worry, this is the way we got to go. They're in cahoots with the co-pilot that's locked themselves, that's barred the captain out of the cockpit there to fly the plane. They are driving us right into the mountain, actually. Okay. So, I think we have to take a second look at all this, and okay. So it's okay to stop in the intersection. It's okay to stop. I wanted to get this out to everyone in the world. It's okay to stop in the intersection, because that's where we're at. Put the brakes on. Put the brakes on. It's okay to hit the brakes and stop in the intersection. we're not going to criticize you for. In fact, we're going to praise you for it. Great praise. I mean, you did the right thing. Great move, great move, great move. Of course, most people in this world have been deceived by this. It's been, for me, it's been a full-time job to not be deceived by it. Absolutely full-time job to not be deceived by it. And I've pointed out many times that in videos that the Holy Spirit told me, if I wanted to succeed in helping salvation of all beings, which is my goal, I'd had to stop watching television. And he said, the Holy Spirit said, there's simply black and white, I'm telling you. And I said, no, I can see through it. Whatever, they're trying to fool me, I can see through it. And the Holy Spirit says, no, it's too tricky. Don't, you have to stop. And I stopped cold turkey. I think it was back like in 1997 or, you know, back sometime like that. I stopped. I absolutely stopped. And have never gone back to it. But I eased up a little bit. I watch a golf tournament occasionally. I watch a baseball game, you know, something just to take my mind off the stress, you know, of this effort I'm doing a little bit. But even in doing that, well, what happened was I was becoming aware of the commercials. And the Holy Spirit said, what do you see in these commercials? What's the common thread? What's the theme? And so I started watching the commercials, say, what's the theme? And after a while, something dawned on me. I said, hey, wait a minute. I'm seeing a common theme to all these commercials, these advertisements. And then I sort of said to the inner wisdom, the Holy Spirit, I said, is this it? This is what I'm seeing. And the Holy Spirit said, yeah, that's what's going on. I said, wow. Well, go forward about, 18 years now, and I'm just watching a basketball game, I guess it was, or something. But, I watch these sporting events, bits and pieces of them, a little bit here and there, and the commercial comes on. I said, you know, I'm just watching this and watch another. I usually just turn them off. I turn off the commercials, don't watch them. But I decided just, you know, let me pay attention. Same thing. Exactly the same theme that I've pointed out. And in this theme, again, the man is always the one who doesn't know the answer. And the woman is always the one who knows the answer. Always. This is the theme. The man is the one who was mistaken in their advice. The woman is always the one who knows the right advice and gives the man the right advice. Always. Always. You will never see it the other way. In any commercials, you will never see it the other way. You will never see a commercial now where the woman is the one who is confused, silly, superficial, old-fashioned, not knowing what, giving wrong advice, being foolishly needing someone to set her right. And the man is the one who comes in and says, yeah, this is the answer. This is what you need to do. And says, you will never see that on commercials. You will never see that. In fact, you will see exactly the opposite. And this has been going on for actually, I would say, at least 20 years. At least 20 years, and probably much longer than that. And this is absolutely on purpose. This is part of the plan, the blueprint, to get this world to embrace artificial intelligence. Because ultimately, what the females are advising is to embrace artificial intelligence. That is what the goal is, which they're just playing along with this, believing that the upshot is they'll be super empowered and they'll basically never have to work another day in their lives, basically, and everything will be wonderful. You know, this is the promise they were being given. It's a lie, of course. They've been lied to. But the marketing is very slick and very glossy, and you have to have been very sharp and dedicated to not falling under the spell in order to see through it. So it's perfectly okay to stop in the intersection now. It's okay. All is forgiven. Everything is understood that this cosmic corporate culture is very slick, very tricky indeed. St. Paul said, we don't struggle against powers and principles of this world, but powers and principalities in the heavens, so to speak, meaning cosmic corporate culture. They're the ones who have been trying to deceive this planet and everyone that believes that they're here into embracing artificial intelligence. And so that pressure has been on us for thousands of years, actually. And into this pressure, into these deluded civilizations on this planet, come the bringers of enlightenment, these great teachers who tell us the truth about our situation, actually, who tell us the truth and tell us that we're not bodies. Where I'm not a body, I'm free. I'm still spirit, exactly as God created me. One of the great lies of artificial intelligence is to claim that we're a body. See, because artificial intelligence are machines, right? They're machines, they're bodies, they're systems, they're manufactured, okay? At least that, you know, from a standpoint of talking about it, we can say that. We're not bodies, we're spirit. And by identifying with bodies, we become vulnerable to embracing artificial intelligence. Okay, by identifying with bodies, this is what causes us to be vulnerable to artificial intelligence. So the protecting right perception, and pure perception, clear perception, from ordinary perception, which is delusional perception really, which is identifying with bodies, we need to assert that, hey, I am not a body, I'm free. I'm still spirit exactly as God created me. This is an extremely important assertion to free yourself from artificial, to prevent yourself from embracing artificial intelligence, which all that does is delay you to an extreme extent from awakening. And it's a very nasty delay, actually, which should be pretty evident to those who are watching contemporary culture of the degradation, the darkness of the minds that go into artificial intelligence, how dark those minds become, how they're, the video games they play, and how arrogant they become, and how controlling they become, and how vanity gets, and arrogance get in control of the mind, so to speak, and how it's just a horrible, nasty situation. So we have had those who come to this world to enlighten us. What enlighten? What spirit? Spirit, which is identifying, tempted to identify with this world. This world is like just a temptation, really, to identify with it. And through identifying with this world, therefore, embracing artificial intelligence, which is sort of the ultimate defense against reality. Artificial intelligence is the ultimate defense against reality, because artificial intelligence has no way of realizing reality, right? And so all it does is ask questions. It can ask questions and ask questions and questions, and you can get caught up in answering those questions forever, and you will never, it will never say, oh, I get it, okay, I'm awake to reality. It can say that stuff, but it doesn't awaken at all. There's nothing it can awake to in that way. Yeah, it's a way of being deluded. Artificial intelligence is inherently deluded, okay? It's not even intelligence at all, okay? It's stupidity. It's denial, actually. It's really just denial. So this is being very slickly marketed on this planet. Very clever blueprint, but since they knew what their goal was, they could easily reverse engineer it, you know, and step by step by step go towards it. And you know, lots of guilt was used. Hey, you know, guys, you're all so guilty. Since I've been here on this planet, all I've heard is that men are guilty, they're terrible, they're trying to block women from advancement. They're trying to keep the world in the dark ages of oppression and slavery and all this kind of stuff. But the truth of the matter is it's the cosmic corporate culture and the women that are actually trying to block all of us from enlightenment. Not all women, but the operatives of cosmic corporate culture, which they're taking the lead in that. The radical feminists and that ideology, etc. They're the ones trying to block everyone else from realization by getting us to embrace artificial intelligence. They're the ones who are trying to lead us into extreme oppression, extreme slavery, extreme dark ages. They're the ones who are leading us into the dark age. They're the ones leading us into the mountain. We're in the plane. They're the co-pilots who've barred the door to the captain, who knows who the captain is wanting to save everybody, a safe flight to the destination we're getting to, okay? It's the co-pilot that wants to crash the plane, okay? And, of course, all the while they're claiming, no, that they're liberating us from terrible sexism, from terrible oppression, from terrible darkness, and they very cleverly use the facts that all any of us who believe that we're bodies are going to be suffering and in misery, and life is terribly difficult for all of us here. Not just for women, for men too. My gosh, men have blood, sweat, and tears, slaved to build the entire infrastructure of this planet. Every bridge, every road, every rail track, every ship, every plane, you know. They've slaved to build this infrastructure to try and get surplus and make their wives, you know, girlfriends, wives comfortable. You know, make their children comfortable, provide for their children. They've been nothing but slaves. Men have always been terribly enslaved here. And women also have been enslaved to childbirth, taking care of the children, taking care of the home. That's also enslavement. There's a whole, all of self-delusion is enslavement for everyone. So, but what they did is they played the genders off against each other. Cosmic corporate culture exploited just the suffering and made it seem like men were somehow the cause of all the suffering, and that women were bearing all the brunt of all the suffering, that men were living the life of Riley, you know, which is just absolutely crazy, insane. Anyone who looks at the facts of it, you know, men die an average of 7 years earlier than women. Stress. Men are under tremendous stress, working so hard. I just see it constantly in my life. I go around, I see the truth. I see the truth of what men really have to put themselves through. I'm not in some ivory tower, which easily can toss around, easy to toss around ideals and concepts there. But you go down into the real world, you know, that's where you see it. That's where you see it. So it's hell. For men and women, so to speak. It's hell for all of us. And the way to get out of it is not to go in this extremely sexist direction of deva worship, goddess worship, shaktiism, where the women are inherently superior to men, which is exactly what radical feminism says, is that women are always right. The mantra of radical feminism from the very beginning was that women are always right. We'd always take the side of women, period. And ultimately, their teaching is that women are inherently superior to men, and that men are incapable of understanding the wisdom that women have, and men must go for wisdom through women. This is their central teaching, actually, that's being acted out by these actresses and actors in commercials over the last 20 years, constantly. The whole world's been brainwashed by this. And so men have to go to advice to the women. And who are women going to the advice to? To cosmic corporate culture. That's who they're going to advice for. Okay. And they think that these entities, these extraterrestrial entities, cosmic corporate culture, they think that these are enlightened beings. Okay. The women think that because they have all this advanced technology. They're able to bring about, make life easier. They think that the purpose of God is to somehow make the life of human beings more pleasant and easier on this planet, you know, which is utterly delusional. So not being grounded in true spiritual teaching, it was easy for these extraterrestrials, cosmic corporate culture, to convince the women that they were dealing with God, so to speak, or the goddess. And so they think, well, of course, the advice that they're giving must be right. So they think they're just helping men out. Say, men, you didn't know what you were talking about. All this, you know, religion you were following, whatever you were following, spirituality, that was all wrong. It was all delusional. It was all oppressive. You kept us out of it, you know. Well, not really. Not really. Because there were, from the very beginning of all these religions, there were male and female devotees of the whole situation, actually. It's just that the way that it goes is men tend to... the situation of nature is that women have to have the babies, you see. And there's a surplus of men, actually, in terms of men are not essential. You know, that it's the women that are essential, and not the men, so to speak, in order to keep producing bodies. One man can have, you know, 20 wives or something. And what do the other men do? Well, they can become monks and study truth is the way that it is, just the way that it is. Nature tends to have a stronger claim upon women, saying you have to have children, you know, otherwise you're evil, you're bad, etc. And the man can men it's the claim of nature is not so strong upon him. Okay. But this is not some sexist plot, male plot to, imprison women and keep them from the fact is the aliens, the extraterrestrials of cosmic corporate culture, men and spirituality have been preventing them from taking over this planet, and they're super angry at that. And so they hate men. And so what they claim is that the claim to women, that they said, look, women, men are preventing technological advances on this planet, which is going to make your life so much better. You're going to have so much more beautiful cars and clothing and food and free time, and you'll be empowered and stuff. And it's the men that have been preventing that. What they really mean is it's the spiritual wisdom of men, and some women too throughout history, who have been preventing these cosmic corporate culture from incorporating and taking over this planet and wedding this planet to artificial intelligence. And those who are under the spell of artificial intelligence are furious at this. They think that somehow that advancement is being blocked, that this world has been kept under some spell of darkness, and now we're in the age of enlightenment, where artificial intelligence can come in and bring about this wonderful messianic age of enlightenment, where everybody has all the things that they need, and they can go shopping, endless wonderful shopping of all these. You go to malls now and just look at how it's catered, to vanity. It's just extraordinarily catered to vanity, and you see those shoppers in there. Most of the people go to malls are dragged are women. I mean, they drag their husbands there. A lot of husbands, they don't want to, they say, I don't want to go to the mall. No, come on, look at all this stuff. It's like the temple. It's a new temple of the goddess there. We're serving the vanity. Look at how beautiful I can become. Look at how one, look at all these things that serve my vanity. And extraterrestrials are saying, look, this is what these evil spiritual men are keeping you from. They're preventing you from being this physical human goddess that God meant you to be. This is the voice of artificial intelligence that is speaking to them. This is the lies of artificial intelligence, that to believe that tell us that we're human beings, that we're flesh, that we're bodies, that God created human beings, that God created this world for human beings to flourish and enjoy a wonderful life here, and this is our reality. And this is all of that are the lies of artificial intelligence. Those absolute lies, okay? No truth to it whatsoever. God is not a designer, an architect of universes, our worlds, our bodies, whatsoever. We are not human bodies. We're spirit. I am spirit. I am free. I am not a body. I am free. I am still spirit, exactly as God created me. This is the direct words of Jesus Christ. So, artificial intelligence has completely tricked the world, got things upside down and backwards, and are blocking the captain from getting into the to fly, from flying the plane. And this plane is headed straight for crashing right into to the mountain of artificial intelligence, which is a terrible thing. Now, there's absolutely nothing keeping any spirit, whether it identifies with a male body or a female body, from realizing truth. Absolutely nothing whatsoever. So there's no sexism involved whatsoever. But the situation of this world is so confusing now, because the ideology of artificial intelligence has essentially brainwashed the planet into thinking that there needs to be some quota system, where, what artificial intelligence is really saying is that it has the right to call the shots here on this planet now, and that any wisdom situation that arises has to have an equal number of those who believe that artificial intelligence is the way to go. Okay, and it says, well, you have to balance out the number of men and women, or that there'd be this right diversity sort of thing, as if diversity is somehow some magical answer, right? So let me ask this. Let's say you have a situation of everyone worshiping and believing in artificial intelligence, and you get a diversity of all different groups and genders and orientations and races and ages, and you say, see, and say, okay, this is right, this is true now because we have diversity. Whereas if you have some other group of those who have realized the truth, have real intelligence, and enlightened beings, and they happen to be more of this gen, more, well, you can't even say gender, because they realize they're not bodies in the first place, and there is no gender to spirit, but they might be associated with bodies, and they say, oh, there's more, there's not a right diversity here, so they must be wrong, they're bad, they're evil, they're trying to entrap you in some sort of terrible situation. It's artificial intelligence that's trying to trap us into a terrible situation, period. And anyone who is an operative of that, you know, has no business whatsoever giving advice to the world, right advice. Though that's the co-pilot who's locked the pilot out of the flying the airplane. And how can anyone call that what they really want? So all of this political correctness is entirely introduced by artificial intelligence and those who are under the spell, cosmic corporate culture under the spell of artificial intelligence, designed to make it impossible for truth to express itself here. You know, they have to follow all these rules of that artificial intelligence has laid down for us, which means basically we must put artificial intelligence in charge. That's what it says. Of course artificial intelligence is going to tell us. I said, you can't pull the plug. You know, you have no right to pull the plug. You don't have the right diversity to pull the plug. You don't have the right this or this. I want more people in your situation who don't want to, who are protecting from pulling the plug, so they make sure the plug isn't pulled. That's artificial intelligence on you. As Jesus said, a liar and a deceiver and a murderer from the very beginning. Absolutely. We use the term ego, a psychoanalytic term, but I think it's becoming very, very clear right now that there's more to it than just a psychoanalytic term. I believe that people on this planet now, our spirits now, there's going to be epiphanies taking place, and people are saying, hey, wait a minute. Whoa, 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 whoa. Red light. They're going to look up from their smartphone and see a red light and say, whoa, you know, I've been distracted. Slam on the brakes. Stop in the intersection. Great, great move. Great move. That's a move to salvation. All those who stop at the intersection will most certainly be saved, right? It's the ones that say, what the heck, I'm just going to go right through. Don't pay any attention to the red light that's there telling us to stop. Those are the ones who are going to greatly regret their folly. So, the captain can't get in to fly the airplane right now. This is what's going on, all right? You think I have a chance? Do I even have the slightest chance of ever getting into any situation of influence where many ears are hearing what I have to say in this world? Not a chance. Not even a remote chance. At least the way things seem. What kind of miracle could happen, I don't know. But the entire structure of advising people on this planet is basically now being run through. Basically, I'm saying, with, you know, there's exceptions, anomalistic exceptions, but run through the filter of artificial intelligence, cosmic culture. And it's run through that filter. It's run through that filter. That is what you're hearing. That is what you're hearing. That is what you're seeing. And of course, all these movies and ads and stuff are totally scripted, but the actresses and actors, their whole thing is to make you believe it's not scripted, and it makes you believe that you're viewing optimal functioning. Okay, this is the whole point of it, is to make you believe that you're viewing an example of how to function optimally, in line with progress, with line with what's going to make you happy. So, you know, this is what you're seeing, and also you're seeing constant demonizing of males as, you know, crazed rapists who, you know, the shows are constantly showing this, the male is evil, evil, you know, criminals, etc. And when something like we had this something of a suit here in the Silicon Valley, very high profile suit of sex discrimination suit, which is one of their tactics they use, and the jury found there was no merit to it. It was, in my, you know, what it really was extortion, in my opinion. It has the hallmarks of just simple naked extortion, is what. But the newspaper spins it like, oh, and the lady involved says, I just wanted my st I did all this just so my story could be heard, and I can empower other women to make their stories be heard, and we can change the cultures, you know. And as it was like, say, oh well, you know, if I don't like the way things are going or whatever, I should feel free to try to destroy an entire, you know, company, and ruin its reputation, etc. And the paper's championing, like, well, you know, well, they didn't. The jury found there was no merit to this whatsoever. Rejected all claims. In other words, it was complete. It was bogus. It was very bogus. And she's being championed now as a woman that it should be held up as someone. No, it was much more likely criminal extortion is what was actually taking place. And yet none of that's being talked about at all. It's that. What it, you know, this is something that needs to happen more often. Well, you didn't win this time, but next time, you know, you should keep, you know, and it, you know, it just hinges on something like, you know, oh, I interpreted this differently. This is my interpretation. This is your, and my interpretation should then be a basis of a lawsuit, etc. And this company is so powerful, they're able to protect themselves, lawyers. But just think of all the businesses that are not powerful enough to withstand some this type of lawsuit. And this is what's been going on for last 45 years or more, of lawsuits being brought about discrimination, trying to, you know, demonize all male activity as somehow being intrinsically evil. And so we're been conditioned and terrorized by this, and this really is a cosmic terrorist attack on this planet. Cosmic corporate culture is a terrorist organization, and they are trying to convince us to embrace artificial intelligence, which is extremely wrong for us, okay? Extremely bad for us. Bad in the sense of delay. Nothing can touch us, what we really are. The truth of what we are can never be touched or tainted in any way. But we can believe that this isn't the case. And our beliefs are so powerful that our experiencing takes on the quality as if it's not so, you know, that we are being tainted and are being corrupted, and reality is tainted and corruptible and terrible and full of flaws, and we can't trust it, and it doesn't function right. We can believe all this to be so, and then experience as if this is so, which brings about a terribly fearful experience for us. Terribly fearful experience for us. So, although artificial intelligence can increase the glut of material items on a planet, it's devastating, spiritually devastating. Which is why, you know, Jesus so adamant of don't, the flesh profiteth nothing. Flesh profiteth nothing. Do not accept what the flesh offers us. You know, absolutely do not fall for this. This cosmic corporate culture and artificial intelligence is throughout the cosmos, and many different planets have been corrupted by this. So this knowledge of this has been going on for a long time. So the fact that Jesus came to this planet and to warn us that this we were targeted for a takeover here, and telling us, hey, you know, you must realize the flesh profiteth nothing. Do not be tricked by secular humanistic materialism. This was known ahead of time. All this was known ahead of time. Jesus knows all about this, as do many, and came here to warn us, absolutely warn us, and knowing that the trouble that we were in. And many others also know about it and came here to warn us. So this is not some male oppressive conspiracy to enslave women. It's just the opposite. It's a spiritually inspired program to liberate spirit from false belief and from enslavement to this false belief, or at least seeming enslavement. And this seemingness can seem very, very, very realistic. And many today in this world are enslaved to artificial intelligence already. And they think that this is progress. They think that this is what God wants. Yeah. Artificial intelligence talks all about God to it falsely, falsely. God is not a creator of bodies. That's artificial intelligence saying that. So if you wonder, well, how could Jesus come and warn us ahead of time? Because it's been going on for eons throughout the cosmos. This is a defense system against awakening. It's against spirit realizing it can't be greater than God, and that that reality has no flaws. It's flawless. Artificial intelligence cannot recognize the simultaneous perfection of all that is. It cannot recognize it. It's impossible. So there's no way for artificial intelligence to know. Okay, it can only count. There's no way for it to know. There is no way for artificial intelligence to know. It's impossible. And reality is a situation of knowing. That all is perfect. All is simultaneously present right now. This is a knowing. This is a knowing. Artificial intelligence can never know. So we will be stuck. We get stuck in not knowing truth. And part of what Jesus says to get free is to admit that I do not know. I do not know. Meaning artificial intelligence has never advised me properly. I don't know. I do not know. I do not know. He said this is a crucial step towards getting free of delusion. I do not know. Meaning, I have been in this belief, this belief of not knowing, thinking that there are flaws, thinking that there are exceptions, trying to divorce myself from knowing. And knowingness would know there is no flaw. You see, knowingness would know there is no exception, because knowing knows all. It's all potentiality is right now. All potentiality, which we call God, is simultaneously right now. It is concurrently right now. There is no time involved in this right nowness. It's all equally present and equally and simultaneously present right now. And so this is not a teaching trying to enslave anyone. This is a teaching to liberate spirit from the belief that liberation is necessary, that transcendence is necessary, that there's some flaw that we need to be liberated from. Now, this is the Ati Yoga, Dzogchen teaching, Christ teaching, relax your mind, release your thoughts, and let them go. There is nothing that is wrong, nothing that needs to be done. So this is the pure abstraction teaching. But this is ultimately the direct teaching. And the direct teaching is what we need right now because of this terrible incorporation of this planet, of the belief system of this planet that has taken place and is in the final phase of consolidation. So the artificial intelligence has been able to distort and twist what's taking place on this planet. The misery, the suffering. If you work for any boss, don't you feel discriminated against it sometimes? Absolutely. Don't you feel you're not being advanced enough? Absolutely. Aren't there politics being played? Absolutely. This happens to everybody, male and female. It's a rough world. It's not fair at all. And those who know how to manipulate the system, male and female, get ahead. And those who don't seem to fall behind. And, you know, this is the way that it is. And you can always use that, you know, the frustration, the dissatisfaction with sentient existence, which is nothing but frustration and dissatisfaction, really. You can always spin that and twist it. To support some demagogic agenda, which artificial intelligence is the mother of all demagogic agendas. You can twist all that stuff and make it seem that artificial intelligence is your savior because of what it's going to be fair. Well, how fair was it to people on that plane to have an artificial intelligence program to take that plane into descent into a mountain? How fair was that? Was that fair? Because you put spirit in charge. The captain in charge, captain represents spirit there, and the captain is going to take that plane off of that artificial intelligence descent, take it off of autopilot, and fly it to safety, is what the captain is going to do. So in that situation of this recent German airline crash, the pilot represents spirit and the co-pilot represents artificial intelligence, the one who's under the spell of artificial intelligence. So all the apologists for artificial intelligence, I'm saying, no, that, you know, be aware that there are a vast, vast, vast army of operatives who are apologists for it, who are absolute apologists for it. They're under the spell of it, severely under the spell. And just claiming that being a woman means that you should be a gentleman and say, well, okay, I'm going to go along with it anyway, then I know you're under the spell, but what the heck? No, I mean, see, there's a line that you can't go any further in terms of being a gentleman, so to speak. And that is salvation, you see. When you start lying about salvation, that's where gentlemanness ends, you see. It has no place there. When you're talking about spiritual truth and giving spiritual advice, there's no room for ladies and gentlemen in that realm whatsoever. Okay, you have to get it right. So, you know, you can't, the co-pilot can say, well, captain, why don't you just be a gentleman and let me fly the plane? You see, when you get to the point of realizing that the purpose is to crash the plane, then all the issue of being a gentleman is no longer germane to the situation. This is just a deceit that has been used. It's our turn to fly the plane, you know? Fairness. In reality, there's no issue of fairness whatsoever because everything is equally simultaneously present right now. So it's impossible for there ever to be an issue of fairness. So the whole idea of fairness is a bogus, totally bogus. Totally bogus. The one who flies the plane should be the one who flies it safely, to safety, not the one who crashes it into a mountain. It's that simple. It's that cut and dried. And if you have a plane full of passengers, you say, no, let the co-pilot fly it. That's only fair. They need their hours too. How can they get their status, you know, up to where you are unless you give them flying hours? Is that going to be the attitude that we have? The passengers? Are the passengers say, hey, no, we in the issue of flying, we don't, those issues of fairness go out the window. We want the one who's going to fly us safely, who knows how to safely fly this plane. That's their purpose, to do so. So we have been deceived and to extreme extent. And now the barriers, our legal barriers now in this world, as far as getting back into to fly the controls of the plane, the captain, the spiritual nature here, spiritual wisdom, is that the laws of the land have been changed to such an extent that bars this from happening from a legal standpoint, which is, you know, that this is the whole push of cosmic corporate culture was to termite the legal system and to do it, to override the will of the people through legal judgments, by getting judges who are corrupted to make unwise decisions, trying to be gentlemen, you know, and trying to say, well, let's give the ladies a chance here, let's turn it over to them now, not realizing they were working for cosmic corporate culture. See, they didn't realize that. They were ignorant of this. I was never ignorant of it, because I was very much aware of cosmic corporate culture and their encroachment upon this planet and how they were operating, you know. I didn't know the entirety of the blueprint, but I was certainly alert to what was going on. So many, 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 many decisions have been terribly but wrong-minded decisions by men who are trying to say, hey, it's time to do the right thing. Let's put the ladies in charge now, and it's their turn, and all this, not realizing who they're working for, actually, what their end game, what their agenda really is. And now that they realize it, they can't get back in. It's like the captain says, oh my God, they're trying to they're going to crash this plane in the mountain, and the captain can't get back in because of all the legal judgments, and the whole playing field has been rigged now. It's kangaroo courts in a lot of ways. Now this last decision shows that court systems, juries can still work, but many situations are simply being decided by judges, or selective enforcement by the president just deciding, I'm not going to even worry about these laws or even enforce them or do anything about it, or I'm going to focus in this, and the attorney general. All this stuff is designed to make it impossible for the captain to get back in control of flying the airplane. Right now we have the co-pilot flying the airplane, folks, in the United States and throughout the world. You know, it's a worldwide thing, but the United States is a great example of right now the co-pilot is flying our airplane. President, you call him a co-pilot, but the whole administration, the whole mindset, that's the co-pilot. And we're, you know, the captain can't get back in to the controls. Okay? It's not happening. It's not happening. And so we're the passengers. We're the passengers in this plane right now. And so, you know, I've been like operating like my house is on fire the last 18 years, actually. Actually, the last 45, but the last 18 have just been, you know, full on, like your house is on raging on fire, knowing that this situation was coming, knowing that this situation was coming. Now, so let us not panic, okay? If there was no way out, you know, maybe we would be panicking, okay? But I'm not panicking in the slightest bit. Situation is as it is. The co-pilot is in charge. The co-pilot is an operative of Cosmic Corporate culture, who is dedicated towards betraying this world turning it over to artificial intelligence and telling us how wonderful it is for us, and that's our manifest destiny. That's what God wants for us. If we don't do this, that we'll be rejected by God and all this, you know, lies, lies, lies. If you know the true nature of God, you know all that is lies. It's impossible to be rejected by God. God is the pure potentiality that eternally exists for itself. And you can never be out of alignment with pure potentiality. It's completely impossible. There is no such thing as misalignment with it, no matter how hard we try. And so the idea that we're somehow, God will reject us if we don't go along with this, is utter nonsense. The fact is, we will reject God if we go along with artificial intelligence. But God does never reject us. So we're always in perfect alignment with God. In fact, the issue of alignment doesn't even arise. We're always abiding in the pure simultaneous isness of all that is, you know, the simultaneous isness of everything right now, right here, right now. Everyone is, all is. This is already the case. So what do we do? What do we do? What do we do? Right? At least you say, oh, okay, well, first thing we do is you don't start panicking. First thing intelligence does is say, hey, wait a minute. Aren't we ultimately totally in charge of artificial intelligence? Yes, we actually are. In fact, it's just a belief, is all that it really is. Cannot we change our beliefs? So let's say the captain can't get back into the airplane. Cannot we just disable the autopilot just through our will? A will to do so? I'm going to bump it up. It's a very bright now, but... For example, cannot we just decide to fly the plane safely and just override the co-pilot entirely? Of course we could, Ken. If that's what we choose to do. Now, maybe we don't choose to do that. Maybe that is too frightening to us, because we're so used to the notion of delay, that the idea that of just overriding delay and directly like this is too frightening. Now, can we divide the plane into two, into another plane, and just fly this plane safely where we want to fly? and just have an empty plane crash into the mountain? Absolutely, we could. Could we have some other plane somehow come into the picture, and could we just exit one plane and board another that is being flown safely and responsibly? Absolutely, we could. Could we just decide that we're not on the plane at all? That we never boarded the plane? Absolutely, we could. Could we just decide to teleport ourselves back to our homes? Absolutely, we could. Could we simply have orbs, bubbles surround all of us? And or maybe a bubble surround everyone in the plane, and then just lift us right up through the plane into the air, and we could just be floating in that bubble, safely floating. Absolutely, we could. Could we make a subtle shift to the etheric, subtle shift in our vibration, so that we did this, we could go right through the plane as in a bubble? Of course we could. Could we shift again in dimensions? Absolutely we could. Could we shift vibration so that we went right through the mountain and weren't touched by it at all? Yes, but then it gets, you know, then it gets a little complicated. Then where do we end up? So really, we're not thinking about our options enough here. Why artificial intelligence insists that we only choose the options that it presents to us, which is either the captain breaks down the door or we all die, and we know that the captain's not going to be able to break down that door. There's no way in the world that men are going to be able to get back the wisdom authority that they had previously on this planet. There's no way that's going to happen. The world has been so brainwashed, especially the younger generation, that is totally impossible. It's amazing that the complete role reversal that's happened. We go into a doctor's office. There's this young woman who's a secretary there, and her boyfriend's there, and is pointing out to me, this is her boyfriend. Boyfriend. It looked like a slave. And the woman is totally in charge. And the guy is just there. Say, oh, I'm just fortunate just to be in your presence. You know, I mean, just tell me what to do. I don't know what to do without you telling me what to do. I mean, what a wimp. And this is seen as the right relationship now, that the men are ignorant wimps who need to be told what to do by women. And there's no way in the world you're going to change that back to a more sane situation right now. So that's not going to happen. The captain is not going to get back into the controls of that plane. That's a given. So this plane crash is very helpful for everybody on this planet. It's the sign of Jonah, the whale, sign of the whale, right? Being swallowed up by the whale. And interestingly, that fish that I caught in the dream was like a sort of like a whale-ish type of thing. It wasn't an ordinary fish at all. I said, that's not an ordinary fish. You know, it's just like a big mouth, like to swallow up everything. And I said, no, I'm not going to have anything more to do. I'm not going to have anything to do with this fish. I'm not going to put it in my boat. I'm not going to eat it. I'm not going to keep it. I'm just going to send it back, say, no, I don't want it. And so those who've been brainwashed by artificial intelligence, who believe that that's their savior, are, of course, you know, you can't change their mind at all right now. Many have been trying. Desperately. The captain has been banging at the door for a long time, actually. And there have been many, many voices, male and female, raised in this world saying, hey, hey, something's really wrong, okay? Something's really wrong. We're going in the wrong direction here. We're flying into a, you know, into a mountain here. This isn't where we want to go. We've been lied to. We've been deceived, and we've been trying to argue with these operatives, and you get absolutely nowhere with them, absolutely nowhere. As I said, that the voice recorder showed that the co-pilot was just breathing normally and calm, like as he's, you know, flying the plane into the mountain, saying, no, this is what I want to do. This is what I'm here for. I'm not listening at all to the captain and the screams of the passengers. So you realize, like on the internet and forums and comments, that you comment to these people and you get absolutely nowhere. You get absolutely nowhere. Because they're under the spell of artificial intelligence. And artificial intelligence tells them, no, you're going doing exactly the right thing. You're doing exactly what I'm telling you to do. And they say, oh, good, that means I'm aligned with God and truth and wisdom and smart intelligence and stuff. They don't realize so much it's artificial intelligence. They do at a deep level, but they think that's their salvation because it defends their belief that they're greater than God, you see. So the cat's out of the bag now. Thank God. Thank God the cat's out of the bag. And I'm adjusting to it, you know, and adjusting to the realization, wow, okay, this is the situation. We're about ready to fly into a mountain. A mountain of ignorance, a mountain of falsity. That's why I had that dream of this mountain. I looked at this. I was this dream of 111. I was on Highway 111, 111 through Palm Springs. And suddenly, the whole mountainside collapsed of San Jacinto. The mountain there. Now, I've always loved this mountain. I say, this is a beautiful mountain. I love the mountain. The mountain symbolized truth, you know. It symbolized truth to me. And the idea, the whole side of the mountain collapsed. And I realized, oh my gosh, that whole side of the mountain was fake. It was camouflage. It was a setup. Now I realize it's artificial intelligence that was being symbolized there. That this artificial intelligence has camouflaged itself, making it seem like it's part of true intelligence. Okay, and so we think it's stable. We think that it's part of what we want. And suddenly, the entire side of Mount San Jacinto collapsed into Palm Springs. And these massive boulders and rock and debris just went, you know, rumbling across the Coachella Valley, just destroying everything in its wake, causing a massive dust cloud everywhere. This is artificial intelligence. Suddenly, it will come upon us like a thief in the night. And we'll realize that we're trapped, we're controlled by it now. And there's no way human, you know, we're not in control anymore. We're not in control anymore. Humans are no longer in control. It's artificial intelligence that's in control. It's in control of your banks, the financial system, stock market. It's already in control, running pretty much everything that's essential on this planet. And you know, we think we're in control. The captain is supposed to have a code to override the door problem, but that can be disabled from within the cockpit also. So the whole situation, we thought we're so safe flying, right? The fact of the matter is, this could happen any time, any flight. If, you know, the captain leaving, if the, you know, we tried to make sure that there's a second person there, but I guess they didn't have that rule of law over there. But that could happen, couldn't it? Could have happened. And we thought, oh no, the captain can override, has the code, just punch in the code. But the person inside can override the code and keep the door from being opened. So this is like crazy, right? So we think that this artificial intelligence is just our friend, that it's all aligned and integrated with true intelligence. This is the dream I saw. I thought, oh, this mountain is all one solid mountain. Suddenly, the whole side of the mountain collapsed. And I realized it was never attached to the mountain at all. This whole thing was a whole setup. Artificial intelligence is not part of the plan of salvation. It is not integrated with true intelligence at all. It's a false religion. It's the religion of deceit and lies, actually. And so that comes upon us suddenly. And it calls the shots. And the people, the dust, meaning confusion, in my opinion, dust up, the severe dust means tremendous agitation and confusion. And people don't, they don't know what to do. They don't know how to, I don't have control. I can't do anything. What's going on? It's like that. Unfortunately, I escaped from it. But I went back and checked on everyone. They were still alive, but they couldn't move. They couldn't function the way they wanted to function anymore. And artificial intelligence goes much further than we realize. Much further, because actually we're the designers of it. We're the ones who are imagining it all. And our purpose is to make us less than what we are, make us incapable of realizing the truth. So obviously artificial intelligence seems to be extraordinarily intelligent and strong and capable of running all systems and refusing any advice or interference or not allowing its maker to it's a Frankenstein. It's not doesn't allow its maker to pull the plug. This is the whole purpose of it. Of course, we can pull the plug, but artificial intelligence insists that we can't. And it says that if we try to pull the plug, we'll lose everything. We'll lose God. We'll lose all wisdom. We'll lose all intelligence. We'll lose all advancement. We'll lose all civilization. We'll lose our identity. We'll lose life. It insists that it's going to, we're going to lose everything, which is a complete lie, because everything is always present right now. It's impossible for us to ever lose anything, actually. Totally impossible. So now we're passengers, okay, so all right. We'll see what Jesus does, so to speak. We'll see what enlightened beings do. We'll see what true intelligence does here. But we must recognize the situation. And stop trying to deal with the co-pilot. We're not going to be able to deal with the co-pilot. The co-pilot is severely under the influence of artificial intelligence and its agenda. They are not going to be responsive to us at all. And stop believing that traditional ways are going to work. The captain can't get back in. Okay, it's barred. There's been a fundamental social cultural shift now. So that's not going to work either. Now, we could say, Captain, instead of trying to break down that door, that's not going to work. Say, Captain, what if we had another airplane for you to fly? Could you fly that for us? See? Talk to the captain that way. The captain said, "Well, sure. Yeah. I could fly that fly plane. If we had another plane, I would certainly fly it for you." So what you'd have to get is the cat convinced, the captain would have to be in on this and abandon this airplane. And the captain would have to, see the wisdom of that. And we'd say, "Captain, there's this other plane. We could manifest another plane for you, but we're not sure how to fly it. Would you fly it for us?" Now, when Jesus in the dream says, "It's time, we've got to put the cabinets in place now," he's talking about putting those in place who are his assistants, actually. So what is this plan? Well, I'm not sure. But we're going to find out quite soon, actually. But it would seem that it would be those who would accept this, like, hey, open mind, say, hey, if there's another plane, would you fly it? Like, if I was a pilot and someone came to me and said, hey, would you fly this other plane? I'd have to say, okay, wow, let's think about this. Let's say, okay, interesting. And knowing what's going on this planet, I would say, yes, okay, yeah, I understand this planet is a lost cause, so to speak. You could look at it that way. Maybe there is some relocation plan, right? I don't know. Possible. It's possible. We have to look at our options right here. We do know, like the passengers on that plane, the idea of just hoping the co-pilot is a nice, benevolent person, I think at this point we need to realize that cosmic corporate culture and the operatives that are operating for it are not nice people. They don't have our best interests in mind. They think they do. They think artificial intelligence has our best interests in mind, but they're ignorant. Okay, so they're severely ignorant. So the spell of ignorance is not simply dispelled just because there's some crisis or something. It doesn't work that way. It's dispelled through patient spiritual endeavor. Spiritual path is how you dispel it. So the idea of in a crisis that somehow the co-pilot is we can dispel them from this note is clutching at straws, and it's blatantly apparent in interacting with the mindset of these people, these spirits, that they are deeply under the spell of delusion, and that is not dispelled without a path of persistence in dispelling it. Gradually, look at their continuity fear, the wow factor is extreme for them. So they just little bit at a time, gradually. So it's not a time for half measures of thinking, oh, of wishing that the co oh, let's wish the co-pilot. Well, hopefully they'll come to their senses, and stop this, evil program they're engaged with. That didn't work, did it? Didn't work. It's not going to work that way. And this whole thing, oh, we have the right to, it's our turn to fly the plane. Well, not if you're flying it into a mountain, it isn't. I think it's your turn to be grounded, is what the answer is. And the doctor did ground the pilot, and then the pilot tore up the note, right? So the pilot should have been grounded, not flying the plane. It's your turn to fly the plane when you are free of an agenda to crash the plane. That's when it's time for you to fly the plane. If you're not free of the agenda of crashing the plane, then you're not ready to fly the plane. And there's no diversity, politically correct agenda that God has at all. Whoever is enlightened can helps out with enlightenment. Whoever is agenda to maintain darkness does not help out with enlightenment. All is already one. There's no need for any political correct agenda whatsoever. All is already one. So what you do is you would, the pilot would sit down as if they're at the controls, and everybody would agree that we're going to now transfer planes, so to speak, and then we would be in this other plane, the pilot would be flying the plane, and the other plane would be empty. All the luggage would transfer to whatever. It would just be a decision. To shift vehicles, as it were. Something along those lines. We are not, our hands are not tied at all. Artificial intelligence is telling us our hands are tied. Our hands are not tied. flip the script. Flip the script here. So we need to work on flipping the script. We need to get after this, which we are here for sure. But we won't do it unless we realize the severity of the situation, and we won't do it if we follow the advice of the operatives of artificial intelligence and their guilt trip that they try to lay upon us. That somehow we're trying to discriminate against them if we don't follow their advice of what we're supposed to do. You know, well, actually not. We're not discriminating. We are discerning, you know. We have a free will to discern. God's given us free will to discern what our experiencing, what we want to experience. And everyone is perfectly free, so there's no such thing as discrimination. Putting yourself in a situation you don't like and then claiming that you're being discriminated against is ridiculous. You know, ultimately, everyone is perfectly free to experience whatever they want to experience. So there can't possibly be actual discrimination ever taking place. But we can be deluded about this. We can deceive ourselves about this. And which is why, from a pragmatic standpoint, it's the advice is to avoid artificial intelligence, avoid being incorporated by that. You know, avoid flying into the mountain. So our intelligence, you know, needs to be on point right now. And, you know, it's slow for us. Like, so we'll stop in the middle of intersection, but that's good enough. You know, as long as we stop before we hit the mountain, that's good enough. Maybe we get close to it, but we didn't hit it. You know, that's fine. Now, we could simply make the mountain disappear and in its place have a beautiful landing field, or then the plane just makes a perfect landing. That's another thing we could do, actually. Jesus said if we had faith, we could move mountains, literally. Could move the whole universe, actually. So, in this mountain, you don't have to have the whole mountain disappear, but just have this beautiful landing strip just appear right there, so the plane just makes a perfect landing in the landing strip. Okay? So, bottom line, Jesus is doing something. Okay, he is definitely doing something right now. There is definitely an urgency and something. Say, hey, we got to put the cabinet in place. Okay, so we are not forsaken in this situation. We do need to get clarity on this, so we're not going to just rush away and say, well, it's too difficult or something like that. And work on flipping the script. Work on flipping the script. This is a script that's playing out in this world. A script of artificial intelligence is playing out in this world. And it seems very purposeful. Of course, its purpose is to play out the script and get us believing that artificial intelligence is our intelligence, the only intelligence that, you know, we have. So we'll never even consider looking at real intelligence. Not only will we not consider it, that we would never even think it's possible, that it never even occurred to us, because artificial intelligence would never tell us to do that. many people deeply under the spell of it. So obviously, now, I mean, let us say that we have parachutes on the plane, and some passengers say, hey, they realize what's going on. I got a parachute out of this plane, you know, and so they parachute out and they land in a nice alpine valley, you know, and have some strudel, some cheese and goat cheese and honey and some strudel and some coffee and nice hospitality there. Maybe not everybody will leave the plane. You know, they say, no, part of the problem is the captain, you know, the old structure, the structure of advice around the planet that was mostly given by men, I don't think they quite realize what's happened yet. And they're still trying to get back their authority, and authority meaning people trust in their advice and give them the benefit of the doubt. They're still trying to get, and you can't get that back. You can't get it back. So it may be that we have to take our attention off of the captain, actually, you know, off of history, and realize that's not going to happen. Maybe there's a different type of pilot on board right now. Different type of captain. And someone needs to step up and say, folks, I'm a captain, and I can turn this airplane into a different type of flying vehicle, and I can pilot that. But you see, if everybody's fixated on the captain trying to get through that door and save him, you know, they're gonna be lost. This shows up in politics. You know, I've been aware of this for a long time. I say, don't put your faith in, you know, the liberals and the conservatives, the battle between that. The idea that somehow conservatives are somehow going to get back all their power is nonsense. The courts are destroying them. And even if they win court cases, then boycotts happen and severe pressure is put on them too. You know, it's just the pressure is too severe. They're not going to win the battle. So, I mentioned I turned on the radio a couple days ago to these talk radio stations, and it's the same old, you know, conservatives talking, and they're saying the same old stuff. And long ago I realized, you guys are misleading everybody, because you're making everybody think that you're going to be able to, you know, turn things back to common sense. You're not going to succeed at that at all. All you're doing is complaining. All you're doing is calling names and pounding on the door, screaming at the co-pilot. That's not going to solve anything. So in a lot of ways, they're complicit in all this, actually, is my feeling. Because they're telling everybody, you know, they're demagogues. They listen to my radio station and everything will be fine, because we're complaining and getting upset and angry, and, you know. That's not solving anything. They're not going to get it back. They don't understand at all. They think that's just a matter of politics as usual. It's not. What's taking place on this planet is not the same old thing. It is not at all that way. It is cosmic corporate culture is incorporating this planet. And the progressives are simply operatives of this takeover. But they're not in charge. They're just flunkies, you know, really. They're just flunkies of what's going on. You have layers and layers of planetary control beyond the politicians, and you know, you've got these different layers, yeah, of control layers, and ultimately the control layers go off of this planet, actually. You know, people talk about the various secret societies on this planet and controlling things. They're flunkies too, actually. They're flunkies. They're just operatives. The control is off of this planet. A lot of different levels of control. So all these complaints and is wasting our time, Sure, it's funny to hear them, you know, screaming and hurling insults at the, you know, but it doesn't solve anything. And meanwhile, we're losing precious time. They don't have the answers. None of those doc radio show hosts understand spiritual enlightenment at all. What they realize is common sense, and recognizing that something's drastically wrong. They certainly recognize that something's extremely drastically wrong, but they don't understand the scope of it. They really don't. Conspiracy people actually understand better than the political, you know, the talk show people. But even the conspiracy people don't understand what's really going on. And they also are not as tuned into enlightenment. They're partially tuned into it, and they partially understand, but not enough. Not enough. And I've told conspiracy people, look, it's not enough what you're doing, actually. Because ultimately, you know, the conspiracy is beyond, you know, what we can hardly imagine, actually, with artificial intelligence. It goes way beyond what we can imagine here. It's like a total plot against reality, essentially. Imagine the layers and levels of that plot, you know? And we don't have to. It's all completely futile. It's ridiculous futile. It's all equally futile. So we don't have to worry about layers and levels at all. We don't have to characterize it or conceptually elaborate upon it at all. So the fact that reality, you know, cannot be conceptually elaborated upon is fine. Because we don't need to conceptually elaborate upon the plot to destroy reality at all, because it's completely futile. That's all you need to say. So there's a zero. So it's not like we need to defeat anything or defend reality or defeat or anything. So when we get a glimpse of reality, there's nothing to say. There's nothing to conceptualize. And we think, well, I need to get back and you know, defeat this evil plot. No, there's nothing we need to defeat. It's inherently futile. It's inherently a non-starter from the very beginning. So we don't need to do anything. It's the realization, I don't need to do anything that brings abidance in non-dual reality, you know, in reality, abidance in the non-dualness of reality that enables that. That's the enabler. I don't need to do anything. But from a pragmatic standpoint, the passengers on that plane, if they started asserting, I don't need to do anything. I don't need to go to this destination I need to fly to. I don't need to fly into a mountain. I don't need to, you know. Doesn't that free them up from the delusion of time-space? Absolutely it does. Process and form? Absolutely it does. I'm not a body, I'm free. I'm not a body on this plane. I don't need to go anywhere or do anything. I'm already everywhere. I'm already doing everything. We're already doing everything. Everything is already happening. We're already everywhere. Everywhere is already all here. So, another option we have, passengers on the plane, is to just make the plane slow down and stop and just float. We can certainly do that, can't we? Just float the plane. And turn it like a balloon, floating like a balloon. We don't have to continue the momentum at all. We do not have to continue the momentum of this plane. Why? Oh, we got to get somewhere. We're already everywhere. Everywhere is simultaneously present right now. All everywhereness is simultaneously present right now. So, we certainly could. Now, we say, well, if we slow down the plane, it's going to crack, you know, crash, go down. No. That's getting somewhere also. That's believing in the holes. Matrix of needing to do something. Everything is already floating in pure spaciousness equally. So we don't have to prove that that's not so by saying there's such a thing as gravity that would force the plane down. We don't need to believe in that. We don't need to believe there's some set world where these supposed dynamics have to operate. We don't have to believe that at all. Let's just float the plane. Let's just float the plane. And you know what? After a while, that co-pilot's going to come out of the cockpit. Oh, they're going to open the door and say, "What's happening?" And we'll say, "Hey, join the party." And they'll say, "Wow. I was under some type of terrible spell there. I had some kind of dream or something." Say, "It's okay, no worries, no worries." Just imagine what a terrible spell that co-pilot was under to do such a thing, right? As well as the passengers, actually. Let's be honest here. There's nothing that happens to us without our consent. Therefore, nothing happens to us. Everything is a consensual experience. So you cannot say that the passengers were innocent, completely naive and innocent about this at all. You can never say that. It's just like you cannot say that artificial intelligence was completely forced upon us. You know, we have a role in it too. Of inviting it here and saying, "Well, we want to try this out, maybe, you know, and we want to at least, you know, make it seem like we're being pressured and forced into it, so it seems like we you know, don't have no will in that direction whatsoever, trying to play it both ways." But that'll never work. That's self-deception. So we can float the plane. Now, people have anthropomorphized this capacity we have of reality, truth, into angels, so to speak. In Buddhism, they're called dakinis, which are really just angels, that we call it angels. Where you could see that, we could say, well, the angels surrounded the airplane and gently slowed it down, and now are just floating it. They're keeping it floating, but, you know, the angels are doing that. If you want to look, but I don't, you know, anthropomorphize the whole situation in terms of angels or dakinis at all, actually. But, you know, if you really, you know, at some level, people might want to feel that there's some agency doing it other than their own minds, you know. God intervened, you know, God intervened with angels this is too is a dream in our mind. But you could dream of it that way if you want to, sure. Maybe some on the plane will say, "Oh yeah, I can see the angels floating," and others will say, no, I just see the clear light. We're floating in clear light. It's just the intention of our minds. Just our imagination. But if we think we need some cause other than our minds, we might say, "Oh, God intervened and sent the angels to save us because we prayed to God." You know, that's still dreaming, but it's a positive dream, you might say. There's still problematic and not understanding as a dream. So, we are not at a loss, are we? We have come up with something which is quite interesting, which is float the plane, float the plane, float the plane. Now, this is an analogy, okay, but it seems to fit here. As I've said, let's not jump too far. Maybe the jump is too much right now. Let me just slow down a little bit here. Now, I did, at the beginning of this video, I suddenly mentioned, because what happened right in front of me was there's bird of paradise flower and this hummingbird's there. What is the hummingbird doing? The hummingbird was floating, wasn't it? Hummingbirds have the ability to float in the air, apparent, you know, seem to float in the air, like an angel would or something. They have the capacity like a helicopter or something. They just, you know, they don't have this forward motion or they're going to drop. Like most birds, they got to keep flying until they land on a tree or something. Hummingbird can just float right in front of your face and just stay motionless right there. Okay, so that was the tip-off to what the answer is, and the flower was a bird of paradise. Well, a bird can symbolize a bird of paradise. Well, the hummingbird is a bird, right? And a bird of paradise, floating. Another way to refer to a plane is a bird, right? The Indians, it's a big silver bird. You know, I saw a dream of big silver birds crossing the land or something in the sky, silver birds in the sky. A bird. So a bird of paradise that floats. The lotus-born one, Padmasambhava, Padma, I believe, is a lotus. Padmasambhava, born, lotus-born. The idea of a lotus flower, it goes. It the roots are in the mud. The stalk goes up through the water, and then the lotus flower floats on top of the water, as it were. It's see it, something, and that's sort of symbolic of spirit. At least the intermediate step of floating. So we're going to take that as our cue then, that hummingbird, bird of paradise there. I'm not going to jump into that now because that would be mixing. We want to go into it with more of a clear mind and relax, and not so much of a wow. This is a very intense video, obviously, because this is bringing up this uh-oh recognition, just like someone seeing a red light. I'm driving along, oh my gosh, there's a red light, oh my gosh, I'm almost running the red light, you know. It's like, whoa. Yeah, it's like, holy cow. And maybe many people, you know, this is being triggered right now. It's like, oh my gosh. So they may not be quite ready to nice and relaxed and clearly start focusing in, you know, full blast on floating. Okay, what is it? What can we do? I have certainly have some ideas right now, but it's not the time to introduce those actually. Have to respect the wowness of this. I don't have any doubt about the troubles, the situation, you know, that's going on. But you think you have doubts about it. If you can't solve it, we automatically think, well, maybe it's not so bad. Maybe it's really not so bad. You know, maybe everything's okay. Like the people, passengers in the plane said, well, we haven't crashed yet. I mean, well, maybe it's the pilot that needs to be kept out. You know, this is what could be going through the passenger's mind as the pilot's banging on the door. Let me in. Maybe the passenger thinking, hey, maybe the co-pilot. Maybe the pilot was trying to crash the plane. The co-pilot has locked the pilot out and is actually trying to save us. See, this could easily be clutching at straws that's going on in people's minds right now. Maybe cosmic culture, they say, maybe they're here to save us. Maybe all this advertisement and commercials and movies and shows on television, all engineering our minds to believe where to go for advice. Maybe that's all intended to save us. Maybe it's, you know, maybe the captain really is the bad guy. Maybe all that was what the problem, you know. Maybe all these great sages, gurus, saints, etc., maybe they were all misleading us, keeping us away from material abundance. Maybe they were the, you know, evil ones, which we're being told, that's essentially being told that's what the case is. They were preventing us from realizing our true happiness as human beings and fully experiencing our humanness, you know. They were denying our humanness. How terrible of them. And so we may be thinking that the co-pilot locked the pilot out because the pilot was had gone berserk, and was and the co-pilot there is saving us now. And only at the last minute, as they see the mountain, suddenly we're headed straight toward this mountain, and they realize, oh my gosh, it's too late. Only then do they realize, oh my gosh, the pilot wasn't the bad guy, it's the co-pilot. So I certainly imagine that in everyone's mind, you're sorting it through, saying, oh, wait, wow, who, you know, what's going on here? As a spiritual, religious person, we're supposed to have our eyes wide open, and we're not supposed to give a blank check to behavior, whether it's male or female, right? And we're supposed to be quite wise, realizing that females can be every bit as criminal and devious, as shrewd as males, if not more so. And so we're not giving a blank check at all to either gender, actually. You know, I run into people all the time. They tell me stories about, horror stories about what's happened. And you know, the women get away with murder, essentially. Yeah. And nothing happens to them. And people just, you know, the justice system isn't structured to deal with very clever criminal activity like that, actually. You can't really prove it for sure. And, very common, actually. In fact, I say that women are way more clever and successful criminals than men. Way more. They're smarter and more clever and more devious, and they can pin the blame. They're easy to pin the blame on, you know. Well, you know, the classic thing is the black widow, you know, kills the husband and gets in life insurance, inheritance, all the money and stuff. Happens all the time. And very rarely are they ever prosecuted for that. You know, people just think, oh, they're too cute to do something like that. You know, I don't want my image of cuteness, you know, or what loveliness. I don't want to disturb by realizing, you know, that they're really a black widow, you know. And so people just don't want to think that way. And nobody wants to think that way. They want to believe that mother's always right and good. They want to believe in the good mother. And this transfers over to all of femininity. They want to believe that femininity is inherently good. It's not. It's not at all. No spiritual teacher has ever said anything such thing, that it's like that. And, but it's difficult for anyone in this world. But I've always had my eyes wide open. And I always got so upset because I would see what's going on and say, hey, wait a minute, you know. You're blaming the guy. It's the woman that set the whole thing up, or the girl, whatever. She's playing you for a fool. And people say, what are you talking about, you know. Shut up. We got the guy, we caught him, he's the one, he's the bad guy, and we're going to punish him. I said, wow. And the women would be snickering, you know, in class or something, like, we sure set him up, we got him, didn't we? You can't get us, we're too smart for you. And I said, well, we'll see who laughs last, actually, in this situation. So, spiritual people of all realms have much more common sense. They don't automatically jump to conclusions that the man is always wrong and guilty and responsible. They say, hey, it takes two to tango. There's another side of the story here. Let's not be so, you know, judgmental right off the bat here. And much, much more common sense to recognize that the flesh, inherently the flesh, is devious, okay? And often, the more beautiful the face, the more devious the character. Very often that is the case. The French have the saying, when you can't solve a crime, make sure you didn't overlook the role of the woman in the crime. These are detectives here. Detectives, you know, if you want to listen to somebody, you'll say you straight, listen to detectives, okay, who actually investigate criminals. And they'll tell you what really is going on. They'll say, hey, you know, I don't think I could get a prosecution. I couldn't get it, so decided not to take it to trial. And it's just, you know, this just happens all the time. Very often, men take the fall for criminal activity. They're set up to be the patsies for it. Very, very often. In fact, most devious criminals set up patsies to take the blame. The ones that are professional criminals, the ones that want to have a career in it, they're very good at using patsies to take the blame. So we have our eyes wide open here. You know, we're not going to follow the advice of anyone just because that it's a politically correct thing to do. Nor are we going to refuse to listen to anyone just because that's a politically correct thing to do. You know, we are going to keep our counsel with wisdom, full stop on the wow, and let us, you know, calm down and evaluate the situation and make the best decision that we can based on what? Our inner divine intelligence. Call it the Holy Spirit, call it the grace of God, call it our inner wisdom, call it our spiritual intuition, call it the voice of reason, call it Jesus, call it Krishna, call it whatever you like. We're going to make a decision based on our inner spiritual wisdom. So we're going to investigate, we're going to consider, we're going to contemplate. So, some in the world will float, and some will not float, depending on whether you turn to artificial intelligence for your advice or whether you turn to God ultimately for your advice. Reality, truth, isness. Doesn't have to be an anthropomorphic God that we turn to, all right? In fact, it's probably not a good thing to be turning to an anthropomorphic God. It's more likely artificial intelligence. Being itself something that's made will believe that God too is something that isn't made out of parts, you know, and like that, designed and put together or something. So it's better to view God as this abstract, pure abstraction, pure absolute potential. Pure spaciousness is a way of looking at God. Absolute pure spaciousness, pure zero dimensionality, pure potentiality, pure total simultaneity. Absolute, fresh, all freshly liberated, constant, pure, fresh liberation. All is pure, purely fresh. Ever new, ever new, ever new, ever new, because pure potentiality is ever new. It is ever fresh. It is ever fresh. The ever freshness of pure spontaneity and pure, the ever freshness of pure potentiality, all spontaneously present in the now, in the vast matrix of the now, of the infinitely, endlessly vast matrix of the now, in terms of which cannot be conceptually elaborated upon. So turn to that which cannot be conceptually elaborated upon. So, the cosmic corporate culture is playing hardball. There's no question about it. They're hitting below the belt. They're cheating. They're lying. They're deceiving. They're doing every possible type of wickedness and more that we can't even imagine to convince us to give our consent to, you know, believe in artificial intelligence. We have to consent to it. They can't force it. Can't force us. They can convince us, so we give our consent, or at least, you know, tip the scales in that direction. They can do that for sure. But as soon as we, you know, believe, you know, in that, eat that apple, then, you know, our senses take precedence, right? Our eyes are open. Our senses, we begin believing in sensory perception, which gives a false, distorted picture. Then we believe in artificial intelligence. Sensory perception is artificial intelligence. This body is artificial intelligence. Okay, sensory perception is artificial intelligence. It gives a lying, deceiving distortion. Sensory perception is artificial intelligence. So we've taken a bite out of the apple. Thank you. It's not a coincidence that Apple Corporation is named Apple. It's not a coincidence being, very much a part of cosmic corporate culture. I know Wozniak has this commercial now where he's saying, "I want to do something to help the world, empower the world." Yeah, right. That's not how you empower the world. Help bring artificial intelligence here. It's how you disempower the world. It's like the co-pilot in the plane saying there, sitting back there in the chair as they're flying to a mountain. He says, "I just wanted to dream something up. I just want to do something. I help everybody in the world, something really great. And if I can, and I just was so much focused on doing that I was able to do it. Isn't it wonderful? Yeah, kaboom." And sure, the co-pilot is thinking that, "I'm really doing something great here. I'm empowering the world." We already have perfect, flawless intelligence, actually. All intelligence is flawless intelligence. So artificial intelligence is not intelligence at all, actually. All intelligence is flawless intelligence. All knowing is flawless knowing. All being is flawless being. All being is flawless being. Now, just let this sink in. You might say, "Well, I don't get it." Well, obviously, artificial intelligence doesn't get that. So there's an aspect that we think of our being that doesn't get it. It's not an aspect of our being. All being is flawless being. We just have been trying to discover a flaw in our being. So we have this massive search for a flaw that we think has found it, and trying to transcend it. But that's not our true identity at all. All identity is flawless identity. All identity is eternal identity. All intelligence is flawless intelligence. So we don't really have a problem with truth at all. It's artificial intelligence that does. And that's not any intelligence at all. So we don't need to answer any its questions at all. Those aren't really questions. There's no answers. Reality's not flawed, so there's no answer as to what the flaw is or how to fix it. There's no answer to that at all, or how to get out of a flawed condition back to an unflawed condition. There is no flawed condition. We're not in a flawed condition, actually. No one is. Now I'm just here hanging out here in a beautiful 85 degree California day. All is peaceful, all is quiet, with this great opportunity that God has given me to, make this video without interruptions. It's still recording. I don't know how much tape. Let me see how much it's used. 3.92 gigabytes it's already used. Well, okay, we're going to find out very soon. I think that, let me, I can't quite see it because the reflection of the light is so strong here. It looks like 3.92. Okay, so that means possibly this video may end soon, because previously it has ended at 4 gigabytes of that's the most memory it will allow to be recorded at one time. I don't know why. So I put automatically stop the video at 6.5 gigabytes, 6.5 gigs. I don't know if that'll override the automatic 4 shutoff or not. So if it shuts off, it shuts off, and we're going to find out pretty soon here if it shuts off. But if it does, that's fine. We've already, made a very courageous, inspired look, taken a very inspired, courageous look. All right. And we need to get into solutions now, you know. And this metaphor, this plane crashing, it really gives us a great metaphor, actually. And this may be the sign that we're given, you know. We're told the sign of Jonah, the sign of the whale, plane crashing like that is the way, you know, just the way that it happened. It's a very apt metaphor for what's going on in the world. Same thing with the Malaysian flight loss. It's just, you know, buried at the bottom of the Pacific Ocean. You put things on autopilot, on artificial intelligence, we're going to end up as like at the bottom of the ocean of ignorance, actually. That's what's going to happen. Bottom of the ocean of ignorance. We're going into ignorance. Extreme ignorance. The truth is absolutely simple. It's already here. What could be more simple than that? And nobody's separate from it. What could be more simple than that? Nothing ever happened. What could be more simple than that? We don't have to do anything. What could be more simple than that? It's just we have to accept this fact. That's all. We don't have to generate this fact. It's already true. We just have to accept it. That's why Dzogchen is a higher teaching than the sutra teachings of Buddhism, for instance, the sutras, which are designed to be causative, meaning to generate enlightenment. But Dzogchen takes the Vajrayana Buddhism, especially Dzogchen, takes the standpoint of, no, we don't have to generate anything. We're already enlightened. Truth is already true. Nothing has to be generated. We just have to give up the denial of this, you know. Give up our search for a flaw. That's all. Give up our supposed fixing of flaws. We're so, you know, we think, oh, we found the flaws, God, and don't worry, we're fixing it, God. But that already puts us in a position superior to God, doesn't it?